Welcome to Losing a Child, Always Andy's Mom. On this podcast, we journey through the devastating experience of the death of a child. Grief is seldom discussed openly in our culture, and the death of a child makes people feel even more uncomfortable. We approach the topic openly and honestly, speaking to people who have lost loved ones and experts who help care for them. Whether you are a parent experiencing loss or someone who wants to support another going through this tragedy, this podcast strives to offer hope and help.
Welcome to episode 249 of Losing a Child, Always Andy's Mom. I'm Marcy Larson, Andy's mom. Today's podcast is from the recent live stream that Gwen and I did this past Monday night. And this is on the work of grief and the idea even of having a work plan. You will hear as we talk about the idea of having a plan in this episode that at first I was a little nervous about the idea, but I do have to say the more that I've thought about it over these past 2 to 3 days, the more I think this is really something that I should probably try and probably many of us should try. So I am going to try to work on this, and you'll probably read a little bit more of this when I do the write-up here in a few minutes, but I like this idea and it's really growing on me. So I hope that you all keep an open mind as well. But for now, I just invite you to sit back and listen to Gwen and I talk about the work of grief. Now, I do have to thank a wonderful listener for writing in with some different ideas on what we should do with some of these live streams. You and I both know her well.
Yes. Yep.
And she wrote in about having like an annual plan, a work plan for your grief. And we both thought that would just be an excellent topic to talk about today. So that's what we're going to talk about. We're going to talk about the work of grief. And this week I was a little more on top of things and I posted 4 questions at 4 different times on Facebook and Instagram. And we just got a lot of feedback this time. Mm-hmm. So I love that.
Yes.
I know. I love that we got so much feedback. And we got so much feedback that we're not going to be able to share everything that was written down. So if you want to find out even more comments, just go to those posts on Facebook. Look at my Instagram story. You can find some other comments that maybe we didn't have time to get to. And I did say that unfortunately we'd read everything and we just can't today. But I do thank all of you for writing in. I think it will spark some really nice conversation today. And if you notice, I'm outside. Yes, I'm at my cottage up north outside. I've got one of my little Andy Angel's Wings little chimes going behind me. So I think that's kind of a fun thing. But yeah, we're up north here for the week. So should we start by going through those questions that you came up with?
Sure.
Okay. Sounds great.
Okay. So the first question was, in what ways have you approached your grief like work?
Yes.
And grief is so hard. And I think work is hard, right? And I think when you can let people know that grief is work, it all of a sudden takes it out of the easy category and puts it into hard, because anything that requires work is not easy.
Yeah.
Does that
you're right.
Yeah. So it gives that sense like, oh, I've got to do something and I have to be active in this and I've got to think about it. It's not just something that's going to, you know, randomly happen for me. Like, oh, now your chimes are going. Andy's here.
I know. Andy's here. We got a little breeze. So we've got Andy going in the background. I love it. I don't think it'll be too. I hope not.
No.
I think it's just him chiming in.
Yeah.
Right? Okay.
Yeah, I do too. I was saying this, and maybe I've said it to this group because I've talked a lot about it since my knee replacement. But I looked at my knee replacement, and what if I had just said, I'm not going to do physical therapy and I'll just see what happens. Mm-hmm. Like, I'll just take my chances to see how my knee heals. Everyone would look at me and go, that's not a good idea. Because in order for you to get to that level, you have to do the work. You have to do rehab. You have to learn these things. You have to work at it. And and I had to relearn how to walk, you know, because I had a bad knee for so long. Some people are having to learn just even how to do tasks of daily living when you're grieving, because it's not the way it used to be. And so rather than just approach it like, well, I don't, there's nothing I can do. I'll just see what happens. If we approach it like work, that we have to do things to make it easier and better for ourselves to heal, I think that's a good thing. And maybe some people hadn't approached it like this before.
Well, and I think that goes back to the original question about having a plan for your grief. About, mm-hmm. I mean, not just thinking about, oh, this is work I need to do, but like, this is, I need to figure out exactly what mm-hmm. I should do. You know, you do this and then this and then this. So,
yeah. And I think one of the listeners wrote in about this that said, you know, some work can't be put off, like paying the bills, yes. you know, putting yes. food on the table. But mm-hmm. it is interesting how when you're hurting and you don't want to do that work, how you can just push it off very easily and yeah. go, I don't feel like doing that.
Well, I even want to read that whole comment because I thought that was a really yeah, good it was comment, a good one. Candy. Yeah. She wrote, there is some work that cannot be put off, work that pays the bills and puts food on the table. Then there's work you can put off, but it builds and builds the longer you ignore it, like dusting or cleaning the bathroom. Grief can easily fall into the second category. I can tell myself, I don't want to face it today. It hurts too much. There are too many other things that I have to do today. But my grief builds and builds if I put it off. The weeks I miss therapy or don't have my online support group to attend, the days leading up to his birthday and anniversary of his death, these are the times I need to purposely approach my grief like work I can't afford to ignore, because it can quickly become completely overwhelming. Just yes. loved that comment. And that clearly so Annie does good. Too, because the chimes are going like,
yeah. yeah.
No, I love that because it she's 100% right that you think, okay, there are things that I have to do. There are things that I don't have to do. And you can mm-hmm. easily just shove that grief into the things I don't have to deal with today because it's just too hard. But mm-hmm. you just can't. You just can't right. keep doing that. I mean, there are times when you can do it for right. a short period of time, right?
Yes.
I mean, I think about my own grief and like doing the podcast and all of that. When I started doing the podcast, it gave me some purpose to my grief and some specific times when I would be working on my grief. And mm-hmm. initially that was Tuesdays and Fridays. Every Tuesday and every Friday were days that I worked on my podcast, days that I worked on my grief. So that meant on Monday and Wednesday and Thursday, when I was working, I could push it a little bit to the back, knowing mm-hmm. that I had a specific time that I was planning to work on it. So it wasn't shoving it off indefinitely, which is, I think, Candy's kind of warning to us all on that.
Right.
I'm going to deal with it today. I'm just going to push it off to another day. But if you went, I can't deal with it today because I have this going on, but I am going to deal with yes. it tomorrow. That's yes. the key. Right.
Right. Because two things come to my mind with this. And I teach about dosing it versus denying it. Like, you don't have to take it all at once, but you have to set it down sometimes and say, for this 2-hour time period or for this day or for this event, I can't do yeah. that. But what we don't want to do is set it down and not pick it back up, because then it doesn't heal and it builds up, like she says. Mm-hmm. So I love that. But the other part that she said was, when my group isn't meeting, I notice, you know, I think she yeah. said that, didn't she?
Yeah, she did. Yeah. She did.
The weeks I miss and or my online group doesn't meet, what I tell people to do is, like, if I teach a grief class and it's every Tuesday night and then we take a break or it stops, I say, keep Tuesday night as your grief night. You've already uh-huh. got that built in. So even if we're not meeting, just say yeah. a Tuesday night's my night. And yeah. so, like, let's say the podcast stops for you. I mean, we all pray and hope it does not, but let's just use this as an example that you could still say either Tuesday or Friday. Those are Friday. My days. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, I think that's really funny that you use that as an example about that just being your night, because we just finished our online sessions, right? Mm. And I don't know if I told you this or if I mentioned this on a podcast, but anyway, one of the women that was in the group also, she used to meet with some friends on Tuesday nights, and it was getting to be really hard to meet with mm-hmm. those friends. These are non-grieving people, and it was just, she was feeling less and less in common with them and not wanting to spend as much time with them in general. And we got done, and she said, I told my friends this is going for 3 more weeks. Because she didn't want to do it.
I love that. I love
and
it.
And I love that. But really, it's not just that she could say that. I mean, she could could still spend time right. on her grief at that time, right? That's what you're saying is Tuesday night's your night to spend on your grief. And if our online support group is meeting, great. If it's not, that doesn't mean you have to go hang out with these women that you just don't feel like you can hang out with right now. I mean, still take time on your grief.
Yes,
but I did find that really funny.
It is very funny because that brought up a man who his wife had died. And on the nights he came to class, obviously the children being taken care of. And he said, I don't want this to end because it's the only night I can focus on my wife and not have to deal with my children. I said, it doesn't have to end. He said, really? I could just still get a babysitter and drive around on Tuesday nights.
Yes, really? Yeah. Really? Oh, and you know, Bonnie just wrote in a really nice comment here. So Bonnie wrote here on Facebook, I went through shoulder reconstruction, and when I didn't work hard, my shoulder started to freeze. It was miserable. Grief work has been similar. I just realized that maybe God had me go through that before losing my daughter to establish the groundwork. Like that.
Really? I love that.
I mean, being able to see that comparison from early on, that you can't just ignore these things. Beautiful.
Right.
Beautiful analogy.
Very much so. And that it does hurt us if we don't do it.
Right.
And that's what people don't know. And that's why I still have a job, is because people find out that without doing the work, it never really goes away. And then they have years of poorly managed grief and need to talk through what they didn't do.
Right. Right.
Yeah.
Well, I want to read a couple more of these comments on here. Like I said, there are lots that I can't get to because there were like 10 people that wrote in, but I did want, there were a couple other that really stood out to me. So Mary Pat wrote, frankly, I'm not always good at my grief work, but I do have one time each week when I spend at my son's grave. I find that to be a really hard time, but in some ways it is also comforting. I have to go to work afterwards, so I think it helps me to kind of put a period on that time. I can stay a few minutes or an hour, but I know I have something afterwards that will engage my mind. I like that comment. Mm-hmm. I thought that was really good because it's a set period of time. It's like a date. She just has this appointment and she knows when the appointment's going to end. So it's not that she's going to sit there indefinitely. Anyway, I just thought that was a really nice comment.
That's a strategy. That's a coping strategy. Just like if you have a difficult person in your life that you have to call, you don't call them when you don't have anything going on. You call them when you're busy and you say, I have a little bit of time to talk to you. And you set a boundary. Because otherwise it's too much to talk to that difficult person in your family.
Right. And if she did that after work or another time when she had all sorts of time, it actually probably wouldn't be as good for her. Mm-hmm. It's something that she can face, I think, because it is a finite amount of time. And then Chrissy wrote in another beautiful comment, too, comparing her, talking about pulling weeds. So I don't know if you remember that one. Do you see that one there? I often think about my grief work when I'm pulling weeds from my flower garden. The longer I let them go unattended, the more they multiply and the taller they get. I don't want to pull weeds, but I want my garden to look pretty. We don't want to do grief work, but it must be done or healthy healing isn't possible. It's overwhelming in the early days, weeks, months, year, but little by little is enough.
Yes.
So I thought that was beautiful too.
Yeah.
And there are just so many great
analogies of that, you know? I think it was Michelle who said it's a second job outside of my full-time employment. And that's the other piece to keep in mind is that this is not for the faint of heart. that it is exhausting. And that's why we have to constantly remind people to be gentle and take care of themselves. Right. So that's why one of the assignments I give to people with grief work is, you know, taking a circle and dividing it into four squares, and your physical health, like your self-care, your social, what are you going to do socially, your mental or emotional health, and then your spiritual health, and actually making a plan to keep that balance, because it is exhausting. And so like the self-care can replenish us and give us the strength to do this stuff. Now, I did ask this woman's permission. I'm not going to hold them on the screen long, but she didn't draw the circle. She didn't but she just kind of took and had a notebook and wrote her plan. And like one was her grief. Then she did social, and it says travel. Oops, travel. And then then I love this activities that I wanted. I'm so bad. Activities, and then self.
So for all of you listening and not watching, she keeps saying I'm so bad because she's holding it up to the screen and it's not being centered properly. So I need to explain this.
Thank you.
Because I'm not going to edit it out, but now we know.
But you see that, like, I'm doing these activities. I'm doing some self-care. And then she said, I keep going back to this paper and adding things. And that's what we call the work of grief, right? Just like making a list.
Well, and this goes back to something that we talked about long ago, and I can't even remember what episode, but when we were talking about riding in a vehicle and you wanting all the tires the same size, right? So if you put out everything like in the spiritual basket and you're focusing on your spirituality, I mean, that can be good, but you can't have that tire be the only one that's big and all these other tires be little. It's not going to function well. So that goes back to that idea of balance a little bit.
Yes,
but I think with that, I think that would be good to, I want to do a little more on that comment of that Michelle said about the second job. So, because she talked about often the weekends is when I catch up on listening to grief podcasts, watching replay of grief support sessions, et cetera. In addition to attending grief activities in the week, it's a check through the things I need and want to get through because I know it's necessary and helpful. It's the work of parenting and staying connected to my child and loving him as a part of my grief work, which lasts forever. So I think that's, you know, really nice though, to make sure you get it all done, but not to go so much that you like overdo things to the point where you get worn down though too. I think it's a great, you know, you got to have a balance there.
Right. And, you know, oftentimes we see it a lot with parents. It becomes a crusade that their grief work is all they do and they ignore the other things of life that have to be done. And it becomes about the crusade. And a lot of good things are built on crusades, you know. But if we don't do the grief work and we're only we're only focused on that, it becomes, so it's all about balance.
It is. It is. Yeah. You are 100% right. Because it's so funny because I've said to people many times, my podcast is not a podcast that you can binge. But yet I meet people who do. And it kind of blows me away. Because I kind of feel like I don't know, maybe go for a walk.
Yes.
Read a
book in my videos,
unrelated to grief.
Yeah. In my video series, I tell people they buy it and they get access to all five. And I say in the first one, don't watch these. Take some time, you know, when you're ready for the next one. And I have people say, I did it all weekend. And I'm like,
okay.
Oh, my word.
I know.
Yeah.
Okay. David wrote, you want to read the comment? Yeah. David just wrote in.
He said, my wife worked through her grief as she was diagnosed with cancer, began treatment 6 months after our son passed away. Through it all, she placed her grief work for our son is her top priority. I say that too. When people have other stresses in life, maybe you have legal battles, maybe you have financial things, you have things that are going on. It is easier sometimes to focus on that. But I just love that he said she still continued to make that a priority, even though she was battling her own illness.
Well, and Karen wrote in, I like this. Karen wrote in, it's the and she wrote and in all caps. We live in the grief and the reality of life. And we do have to live it all at the same time.
Yep. And that's what makes grief exhausting in two, is that we're living in two realities.
So there are plenty of other comments on that first question, but considering we're, you know, quite a bit in, we've got to go on to question two now, which for you, well, you originally gave me as question three. So just so you know, when you read it, question three, it's only because I got off a little bit on my days. So two had to become three and three had to become two. So go ahead. You want to read that?
Yes. What the question is, it says, can you think of a situation where you developed a plan ahead of time because you knew your grief or emotions would play a part in, you know, in the event or what you had to face? So,
okay. Yeah. And many, many comments on this.
Many
comments. Yes, which I do love. Again, we're going to have to, just kind of pick and choose a little bit here.
Right.
But do you want to start with something that stood out to you?
Well, the very first line was, Alexis wrote, I feel like I always have to have a plan. When I go to church, I come in right when it's starting and sit in the back. When it's over, I duck out real quickly. I'm so glad she said that because I tell people those things that overwhelm you, if church means something to you, don't stop going, because that feeds that other part of our spiritual soul, but find a way that makes it work for you now. And that's exactly what she did in that plan. Like, I sneak in and I sneak out. And I had one person, the way their church, the Catholic Church, does communion, it's towards the end. And when she gets communion and goes back, she keeps walking right out the door. Yeah.
Oh, no, I've done that. I've done that. Yeah. Ours is towards the end. I mean, okay. I think about all the things that I did at church to make it a little bit easier. So we have a time when we pass the peace. And for the first year and a half until COVID hit, a little bit at first, my family used to cocoon over me. Like, I think I've shared this, that they would like go over top of me so no one could get to me. And then I got to the point where the sanctuary that where the contemporary worship is downstairs, and it's just, there's a door to the kitchen just off to the side. I would hide in the kitchen. I would go in the church kitchen during the passing of the peace, so I didn't have to look at anyone. I didn't have to see the sad looks. I didn't have to do any of it. And then again, right after communion, they say a communion blessing. Then they sing the closing song, which is always a really upbeat, happy song. And we got our coats on and walked out. And I don't know if it's that my family necessarily needed to, but I needed to. I couldn't do that part. Like, I needed to be at church, but there were some things that I didn't want to do. I didn't want the clapping, super upbeat song at the end. Just didn't. And the passing the peace was awful. So that's how I made that work. And then on particularly bad days, I would actually go up in the sanctuary, sit upstairs in the same spot that I sat in for Andy's funeral, and cry. Or sometimes even, you know, go all the way to the front and kneel down and cry because no one would be in the sanctuary during the contemporary worship. So there are lots of things that I have done, like little plans that I do to help me through. And that's just kind of what I've done, you know?
Yeah.
And that's obviously all changed a lot.
Right. But what I love about that is it has changed, but it did last a while and it had levels to it. And I think at the end of her comment, she says it's been 14 months since my Elijah died, and it's still so hard. I just want to give her that.
And then here Mary Pat wrote again.
Isn't very long.
On Sundays, I always sit. And during worship, if you know, at a point where she can leave, she always sits somewhere where she can escape. If something ends up being too much for her. And I know she's years into her grief. So, you know, I'm sure she can take that as a bit of comfort that this does last for a while.
Right. Yeah. A couple other people did talk about this, about they're not sure how they're going to feel until they're in something and have that leaving without any guilt or explanation. Many people talked about having access to a door or, you know, driving separately, that sort of thing. I love that.
It's amazing to me about how many had to do with church.
Yes. Well, and I always say, because I think a couple of reasons. I think families put on their best. And I work with not just bereaved parents. I work with widows. And it seems like such a family day, and people come as families, and it makes widows feel all alone. And if your family has changed and your child has died, you look at other families and they all look so intact. The other thing that happens is that our heart is more silenced. Music plays a part. You know, we're all those other things. We're not doing anything else. We're not mowing the lawn. We're not, you know, folding clothes. We're just sitting. And it allows those thoughts that maybe we've pushed off to come in. Somebody else said in their comment, I can't read the whole thing, but it said, when Bonnie also said about leaving and having the exit, I have been able to keep myself together and grieve at home private, but it is okay if I don't at some point. And what I wanted to say about that comment is that some people are never going to be comfortable grieving in public, just like some people don't talk to strangers. You know, like if you're standing at the grocery line, some of us, you know, just start shooting the breeze. We're just different. And so it's okay if you've never been a public griever. I just wanted, she said that and I loved it. And I just wanted to be able to say, yes. And it feels more under our control. It just feels where we're comfortable and safe. We don't have to grieve out in public, but life demands that we go there. And so that's why, because our grief stays with us, that makes it so hard.
Well, I was going to, Dana had written in a couple of comments that were good too. talking about a couple of years ago, I had to take my youngest to the bathroom during my older kid's Christmas program. I took her out the side door, which led to the hallway outside the gymnasium where a high school basketball game was going on. I looked up and a bunch of Brogan's friends were standing there. It basically smacked me in the face. Needless to say, I don't use that door anymore, but I prep myself for what might be on the other side of the door. Now we two sit in the back, up in the balcony. I discovered there's a door up there that leads to the outside of the building. Discovering it was like a godsend. It's my favorite exit route. I loved that.
I do too.
That was a great comment because it kind of answered both of two of questions, right? And then that escape route, just to know. And it's like secret. Nobody even has to know that it's got this extra
But again, plan. How grief surprises, like that smacked her. She didn't know that was going to happen that day. She was simply just taking her child to the bathroom. Just like you could be riding in a friend's car and they turn on the radio and a song comes on, or you have a smell or a thought or something and you can't control that. I've told this story before, but I believe I have. But anyway, long story short, a woman's husband died in the early part of December and they owned a company and she still had to do the company Christmas party. We talked about having an exit plan and, you know, she might have to go. So after it was all over with, I said, how did it go? She said, Gwen, I made it through the dinner. I greeted all of our employees. I gave all the awards. I said what my husband would say. After dinner, I visited with people, but she said, when the band started to play, I could not get out of there fast enough. Like just that music and the people dancing, like at that moment, it's the tipping point and I am out of here.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I don't think you have told that story, actually. That was a new one. I've never heard that one before.
Yeah.
No, it's again, that unexpected, you know, she braced herself for all these hard things, right? It's like we've talked about before, that analogy that someone was recently using about the speed bumps and the potholes. Like she saw all of those speed bumps. She had to do all of that stuff that her husband would have normally done. And those are all speed bumps that she knew were coming. Mm-hmm. But the band playing, that was a pothole that she had no idea.
Right. Because
had she known it was going to be, you know, affect her emotionally, she could have probably prepped herself for it and maybe been more okay. But she just couldn't.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Now, someone else has said this before on here, so I'm not sharing out of turn. It was not in any of these comments. But when it was something we did about the holidays or other events that they said one of the parts of their plan or when these things happen, like they have to go to their, because another person wrote about going to special events from their daughter's friends, you know, and those kinds of things. Yeah. Those are hard. One of the things this listener said, I remember, was I limit the alcohol on those things. Because it could be very easy, like to sit at a wedding or a grad party and just say, well, I'm just going to sit over here and have a few beers to numb myself or whatever. And she said that made her emotions so much worse. Like, she
I would be certain it would. Yeah.
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 Mm-hmm. Yeah. Oh, because we didn't address someone else mentioned that when another person passed away and they have to go to the funeral home or visitation.
Oh, yeah. 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 That was disgusting. That's a good one too.
Bring up. Yeah. You know, and with the church that my son and I went to for many years, he went to school there. His memorial was there. We have a long history of memories. Those are really hard. You had to prepare herself to see people she hadn't seen in a long time, to know there'd be many people there, and the memories walking into that church consuming me. But she said, I also did a lot of self-talk before going. I told myself just to greet the family at the visitation before, maybe stay. But she ended up staying for the whole funeral. She said it was hard, but I was glad that I was able to get through it. And that's the other thing, is we do have to celebrate those victories when we do make it through something difficult, is we have to say, I did it. Like, I didn't think I could, but I did do it.
Well, and even if you can't and you don't get all the way through, we can certainly find something. I mean, to celebrate.
Right.
I think about a woman who was talking about, oh, she was going to go to this compassionate friends group. She's from in Australia. She's going to go to this compassionate friends group in Australia, and she didn't make it. But I think she may have gotten ready and gotten in the car. And I was like, hey, cool. Let's celebrate that. You got ready. You got in the car. You tried. It didn't happen. Let's try again next month. I mean, it's more than had happened the month before, right?
100%. I tell people, I look at people sometimes when I'm counseling them. I mean, I can even do it virtually. I'm like, do you have mascara on today? Wow. That's a big step. Like sometimes just celebrating that we're wearing mascara, you know, because so many bereaved people don't wear mascara because you're going to cry all the time.
I know.
One of the widows.
Just celebrating the little difficult things.
I mean, you have clothes on. You got dressed today. You breathed today. You are killing it. Like you are doing it. I shouldn't say that.
You're doing it.
You got this thing.
Okay. So the next question was, do you have any sort of written plans, goals for your life? How about for your grief? That was your next question. On Facebook, there are only two comments. Do you find them?
Right.
Because I'm going to try to see if there were any on Instagram on that one.
Okay, I'll read one.
Okay, so you read the Facebook ones. We could do all these because nobody seemed to have a written plan. So,
well,
which is fine.
Just take one day at a time. I can't look into the future anymore. I used to be a planner and used my agenda, but now just take one moment at a time. And that is where grief people live. It is survival. I mean, that's what she's saying there. Right now I'm in survival mode. I'm just trying to breathe. And that's what I tell people. Your greatest job is survival. And that's what that's saying. Like I can't think about anything else but just how am I going to get through this moment and this day. And then the next one says, nothing written, but I do hope to one day be able to enjoy life again. I just wake up in the morning and push through the days, smile and pretend to be happy when it's necessary. I continue to work on my grief, support group counseling, journaling, and hanging with the wonderful bereaved mamas I have met over the past 4.5 years. And that speaks a lot right there, is that sometimes we don't have a written plan, but boy, I need to be with my people just needing that. And that's going to come up again in the next one. I mean, we can talk about that.
And I'm looking to see if anybody wrote anything on Instagram and nobody did, but I do want to say a few of the other ones from the last question were a lot of like weddings, birthday parties, grad parties, always have an escape plan. Somebody else wrote they always have to avoid parties now. The next one was a first Mother's Day after loss. Drove 2 hours to explore caverns, deepest, darkest hole, good distraction. I like that.
Oh, like, yeah. Probably could relate to it. Felt like how they felt. Yeah.
I thought, oh, shoot, I gotta share that one. I know it's stepping back to the last question, but
no,
that
but was that's
such a good response about exploring a cavern.
I do have to say that the woman who suggested this does have a plan, like a written plan of what she works on. And again, as we're all different, some people do need to have that. And the one I shared with the woman, you know, having her divisions of this is what I'm going to do for self-care. Here's my social things. Here's my people. I often say sometimes we do need that visual. We do need to be able to see like, oh, I have things I can do. I have things I can work on. I have people I can contact. So you don't have to write your plan, but it is good. I mean,
I'm not one to write a plan either, but I can see the benefit. I can see that it would be wise to maybe do it, though.
There are some grief counselors who enforce that. That's their whole, that is their whole method of work, is you have to develop a plan. We need to write it down, and this is what you're going to do. This is what you're going to, you know, and that they have a plan. People.
Man, and I think that would be really, I was like, I don't think I would be happy with that actually.
Yeah.
If I had that forced on me. I don't think.
No, I don't think we have to force it, but I think just giving
see if people idea. Comment from that are listening right now, if anybody has comments on that, anybody has thoughts, because
Maybe someone went to a counselor who said you have to write down your grief plan. I don't know, but it's funny because I've mentioned, you know, my video thing, and it comes with many, many handouts. And some people will read every handout, answer every question, and do it to the T. And other people never look at a handout. They watch the videos. Yeah. I didn't even know there were handouts. Either way, you know, it's just their style.
Yeah.
So, right. You know. But
all right, go ahead. Sorry.
I was just going to say, my thought was though, that when you don't know what to do, sometimes writing down, like you need to do this. Like when people are depressed or have things, like you have a plan for them, right? Like these are the things, and it is very good to have a visual. And so it's not a bad thing, but you don't have to do it, is basically what I'm saying.
So we can move on to the fourth question.
Sure.
So the fourth question, again, got more comments. So the fourth question was, can you share a tangible activity, group, book, trick, or anything that has been vital to your grief journey? So lots of comments here.
Yeah.
I want to start with one that Tama wrote in. I know it's not a group or a book, but maybe a trick. I find ways to still take care of Eric. I know that I will always be his mama, but in my grief, I also need to take care of him, as all mamas want for their babies. Taking care of his flowers at the cemetery, having a vegetable stand in his honor, finding ways, doing things to make him proud of his mama, writing, journaling to him, to check in on him, always sharing as much about him as I can with his younger brother, who only had 19 months with him. I thought that was beautiful.
That is beautiful. Very beautiful.
And I love that. You're right. That Tama, is that's just a trick. That's not necessarily, you know, something that you can look to like, oh, this specific book or this specific group or this specific whatever. But it's a trick that's with her every day.
I'm going to go a little deeper than that. I think it's more than a trick. It is a need that all bereaved people have. Is to search for meaning and to recognize that person in your life. Basically, what William Morden says is to find a place that they fit that still allows you to move along. Yeah. So you're living life, but you're still having, like, you have the connection to them. It's different now, but we're never not going to have that connection, whatever it is, right? Yeah. So it's a need that we have, especially with our children, I think.
Yeah. I mean, she's so right. I just, I mean, that's why did I call the podcast what I called the podcast, right? I called the podcast Always Andy's Mom because I still want to be Andy's mom. And I still want to be his Andy's mom every single day and do things for Andy as his mom. And it's just not something you can just give up and just stop being Eric's mom or Andy's mom or everybody's mom, right?
You absolutely. Can't. Absolutely. And so I do think that we find ways to honor them and remember the person and recognize them in our life and who they are and talk about them. And I love what she said about talking about him to the younger brother. I think it was a brother you said, you know, that only had 19 months with him. People are so afraid that people are going to forget. And we need to do that because they're not going to forget if we keep doing it. And she's doing that. I have to go back to someone wrote in.
About the plan. Someone wrote about the plan. And I think we should go into this because this is where I was coming from. So you read that. You read the comment.
I feel like having a plan would set me up for failure because grief is so unpredictable. I'm sitting on the edge of being a first-time grandma. And for some reason, that has brought on a new wave of grief. A little backsliding with the sad emoji. So
I so relate to that. I so relate to that. Having a plan would set me up for failure. That would be my fear. That it's so funny because I couldn't quite put my finger on why I didn't like the idea of the grief therapist that made you had a plan, have a plan. And I thought, and she just said exactly what I was thinking, but not able to kind of say. It's because I would be so worried to be not do it right and to not do the things on the plan that I would consider myself a failure. And so that's what would scare me about the whole idea of having it.
Yeah.
Which and I know is not what they want. I mean, I know it's that you don't have to do everything on the plan, whatever, but I'm kind of a rule follower. And when I make a decision, I'm going to want to do something, I plan to do it. And if I can't, then it does feel like a failure to me. So I mean, I used to always say this to Eric for this is just years that I would like set my expectations sometimes kind of too low so that I knew I could reach them because if I set them too high and I don't attain it, then that's really bothersome to me.
Right. But some people do need boundaries. They need to be like, I need to live inside of this, just like some of us are list makers and some of us aren't. So it is so different. And that's why grief is so not uniformed. And as to use her word, unpredictable, as we just talked about, it hits us at strange times. But there's no set way because everybody's different.
Yeah, everyone is different.
Yeah.
And that the plan idea, I'm sure, works lovely for lots of people.
Yes.
I mean, I'm sure just because they like the guidance, right? And we talked a lot about the woman who sent in the question. And I think she likes that guidance. She likes to know mm-hmm. that she's following this path.
Right. And to have something like, if it is out of control, maybe the list gives some level of control. Of things that I yes. can do and work on. And grief mm-hmm. is very out of control. So having that, I always look at it. I tell people, when I'm telling you all this stuff, think of it as a buffet. And when you go to a buffet, maybe you don't like coleslaw. You don't put coleslaw on your plate. But I just wanted you right. to know the coleslaw is there. Right. And so I look That's at this, good. All these suggestions as a big buffet. And some people are not going to put a lot of these on their plate. They're like, this is what I like. It's these two things, meat and potatoes. And that's all that's, then that's the way you're going to grieve too. Like, this is what works for me. I don't need all that other stuff. And some people are like, oh, I've never tried that. Let me try that.
Yeah. Right. We're all right. different. Right.
Yeah. The other thing that this woman wrote in was about being a first-time grandma that's brought a new wave of grief and a little backsliding. And I just want to encourage her that it feels like backsliding because maybe you were on an upward. And for those who are just listening and not seeing my hand, I'm acting like I'm climbing a mountain and going up, that yeah. when we hit that, and it's like we've fallen off the cliff, right? And now I'm back at the bottom. But you're really not down as low as you were before. Like, this is just a new part of something that you have to grieve, but it doesn't mean you're back at day one, right? Mm-hmm. It's a new mm-hmm. thing that you have to face. And then when you pick back up, you'll pick back up where you were, which is totally different from it than at the beginning. So I just kind of want to explain that. And it's very natural that any life change, like she's mentioning here, and any, can I just say joy? Sometimes,
yeah,
you know, those joyful things, they're so contradictory to thinking.
Mm-hmm. Well, and you, yeah, because you end up feeling some guilt over having the joy too.
Right.
And like, things just aren't as joyful as there should be. Right. Mm-hmm. Your grandchild won't ever know their uncle, right? I won't know their aunt. And that's just, mm-hmm. just doesn't feel fair. And it brings it all back again.
Yes. So much.
Okay.
So.
I do feel like we should mention some of these books because there are a lot of books mentioned in the comments. So like the Nancy Guthrie books, Holding On to Hope and Hearing Jesus Speak Into Your Sorrow. I have definitely read Holding On to Hope. I have not read the other. Have you read them?
Yes, they're very, very good.
Both. Yeah. I loved Holding On to Hope. That's for mm-hmm. sure.
Yeah. And
let's see. There
I just want to say that some of these books, even if reading them is overwhelming to you and you don't have a support group in your area, but you know, like one or two bereaved moms, you could just pick one of these books. Maybe your plan for the next year is to pick one book and read it with another mom and then just talk about it.
Yeah. Well, we've got a little group that's going to start doing that, actually.
Okay.
We are we're going to start next month. So, and somebody picked a book and we're going to go through the book together and that's awesome. Will be great. But there are, I mean, a lot that were shared here, A Grace Disguised, Beyond Living After Losing a Child. They said pretty much anything written by Anne Voskamp. There, mm-hmm. The Rare Bird. I love that one, of course.
I love that book. Yeah.
There are lots here. Oh, Lament for a Son. Of course, that's mm-hmm. the one that I got like 9 copies of. Mm-hmm. Hope When It Hurts. It's Okay That You're Not Okay. These are all books. This new one, Comfort for the Grieving Parent's Heart, Hope and Healing After Losing Your Child by Gary Rowe. Do you know that one?
I don't know that book.
I don't know that one. She wrote excellent book, all in caps. So it makes me think maybe it's one that we should get.
Wait, was that on Instagram or on Facebook? I don't see that one.
By Sandy. Mm-hmm.
Yep.
And then Surviving Sorrow, A Mother's Guide to Living with Loss. There are quite a few books on here. So again, go on there and you can see some of those others. If you feel like you want to have some summer reading on mm-hmm. with some of these books, I think they could be really helpful.
Helpful to people. And I just want to say though, that again, if we're talking about how different we are, some people reading, especially early on in their grief, is just
I couldn't do it. Yeah, I couldn't do it at all. No, so it was too hard to concentrate.
Yeah, if someone's listening going, oh, people, I couldn't do that.
Yeah, but I have lots of friends. I mean, these are lots of my friends that wrote in all this. Like, all these million books. I have not read nearly that many books. I've read a few books now, but at the beginning, I wasn't reading anything. And then there are other friends of mine, though, that's all they can read, right?
Right.
That feels like only books on grief and they do read lots of books on grief. I just find that I can't do too much of that, but more now, certainly than I could at the time.
I needed short chapters in a book. That's why some books I don't understand. Yes. They don't, if some books I looked at and I thought, oh, you don't understand grieving people because you've written way too much here.
Well,
I like books that are easy to read.
You know what? We're talking about books. We got to give your book a little push now.
Well, thank you.
When is a book now? I have my own signed copy. It's lovely. Do you want to talk a little bit about your book? I can't even believe that I almost didn't do that.
No, it's fine. But it's a
conglomeration. It's two people wrote it. So
yeah. Bethany France, she had experienced two different devastating losses. One a death loss and one something else. And the world didn't know what to do with her, being a single mom. And she said people weren't getting it right. And she kind of kept a list, and, you know, it's like, oh, you should make that into a book. And then she asked me to join her and kind of speak on the professional end of that. But I always thought I'd write a book for bereaved people. And this is not necessarily for bereaved people per se. It is how to help a grieving friend. So it's titled Not Another Lasagna. And then how to truly help a grieving friend. And I have found so many bereaved people reading it, though, and going, oh, I just feel so much better because I hated when people did that or didn't do that. And so bereaved people are enjoying it. But I always say, give this to your friends.
Exactly. You go buy a pot copy and then you give it to your friend.
Exactly. It's on Amazon and Barnes and Noble. Pretty soon there'll be a link on my webpage directly to it.
I think it's really helpful. Obviously, I read it early on. I was reading it kind of throughout a little bit as you were writing it, even before edits came through and things. So I feel like I've known this book fairly well. But I'm excited for you to have it out.
Thank you. The only other thing I want to say to your listeners is if you do read it or you have suggestions of what was helpful to you, we've already decided that we're probably going to do a second edition, but it's going to be from people who have read it saying, you know what I found, and it'll be everyone's book. Not just Bethany and
I. I like that.
So thank you for that. I think in going
and the
on
chapters are short. That's the one thing that made me think of it too. That Michelle just wrote in, I needed short chapters in a book. Yeah. And I was like, yeah, they had pretty short chapters in their book too.
The other thing is we have quick tips, because what I said was, if someone gets a book on how to help a grieving friend and they go, well, none of my friends are grieving, but they get a call that the person had a tragedy, they're not going to read that book the next morning, right? They're not going to sit and speed read it. But we have quick tips at the beginning or at the end of each chapter for them to go, I need a quick lesson because my friend is hurting and I've got to get there in the next hour. And so.
Did I tell you about the medical student that wrote to me?
No,
I don't think I did. So Eric and I recently gave a talk, a pediatric grand rounds talk at DeVos Children's Hospital where I'm working around and things. So we gave this and it was entitled Grief, What They Didn't Teach You in Medical School.
Right.
Because it's primarily the attending pediatricians and pediatric residents that attended. But there were some medical students there that were on rotation. And one of the medical students, she said she sort of laughed at the title because it was, you know, what they didn't teach you in medical school. And of course, she's in medical school. So I am teaching her in medical school. What's even crazier is that the nephrologist, the kidney doctor that she'd been working with, sent her there to go to this talk because he thought it was something else. He thought it was going to be a case study on some sort of kidney problem. Okay. So he got the week totally wrong, sent her to the wrong thing. And she sat here and she was like, well, this isn't what he told me it was going to be about. But she sat and, you know, listened to the talk anyway. And then like less than a week later, she gets a phone call from her mom saying her cousin had drowned and they were coming to pick her up. And so she came and picked her up. They're driving to the aunt and uncle's house. And her mom turned to her and said, so what did they teach you about grief in medical school?
Wow. That is so.
She said before last week, I would have told you nothing because they hadn't taught me anything. Mm-hmm. But now I actually do know some things.
Yeah.
And what's funny is throughout those whole several days as she was with her family, other family members kept coming up to her and saying that same question. So what do you know about grief? What can we do to help? All of this stuff. And she said, I just kept using things from your talk. And she had no idea that a week before, you know, when she was listening to this, she just thought she was at the wrong thing, right? Because she was sent to this by accident. And it turned out it was the perfect thing for her and so incredibly helpful to her family and her aunt, and for her to be able to say some things and give family members some ideas on how to help them in these next weeks and months.
So beautiful. We could be here all night if I told you how many times, like, we presented something when I worked at Starlight. We'd do a seminar and a school would come and think, you know, they're just doing some prep work, or maybe we offered CE work or something. And then their school faced a tragedy. They said, had we not come, we wouldn't have had those tools. And I've had some people buy my book just because they're my friends. And then they're texting me going, oh my word, our family had a death and now I have this book. So it happens all the time. And it's so beautiful. I do want to address something that Bonnie wrote in. She said, it's so weird. I was barely functional, but all I could do was read about grief because I was so confused about the difference of the grief and losing my parents. And I was so confused. I also was so desperate to know where my daughter was.
Oh, I was just going to say, that just goes to show what a difference is losing your child and losing your parent, and different relationships that you're in with the people that you have lost, that the grief can be totally different. And you feel like you kind of know what it's going to be like, and you don't. You don't have any idea, because it's a totally different relationship and situation. And losing a spouse is different than losing a child, is different than losing your sibling, your parents. I mean, they're all so different from each other. And that's hard to understand, I think, until you experience it.
Agreed. But I also just want to address, not that we're answering the question of where her daughter was, but like, sometimes we are reading to find a specific answer to something that is unfinished, or just like, we don't have, they're unanswered questions, and I need to know this.
So I've talked to lots of moms who want to read any book they possibly can about heaven. They just read all sorts of books about heaven because they want to know more. Because I feel like that's where my son is. I want to know. That's where my daughter is. I want to know. And so they read all of that.
Well, and I explained to police officers and different people, that's why people sometimes want to read police reports or want to read things. Like, I want to know how this happened or what the details were. And so it's not morbid. It's we're searching for things. And so I just wanted to address that. But before we end, I think we talked about books that were helpful, but a lot of the people talked about three major things, right? Individual therapy. And I want to describe, just for, if we're going to be helpful, the difference between therapy and counseling. And I think sometimes we put the word therapy out there, but we're not really in therapy. We're in counseling, because therapy is more long-term. It would be more like an engine rebuild, where there's something really deep and they have to take all the pieces apart. Less than 7% of bereaved people actually need therapy, which is something very deep that goes on for years and it's very intense. And then they build it all back together. But a lot of bereaved people need counseling, which is more of an engine tune-up, where I was going along fine. This thing happened in my life. You don't have a lot of stuff to rebuild. We don't have to, you know, go deep into your past of, but now this happened. And so it is valuable, whether, you know, the difference or not, it is valuable to have someone outside your family to talk to. Now, do I think everyone has to pay for a counselor? Absolutely not. But do we need someone we can talk to? Yes. And I just want to point out how many people said that.
Well, and I think that goes into support groups, though, as well.
Yes, that's the next thing that I was going to say.
I was wondering, you're probably transitioning into support groups.
So many people said that, and we've talked about it, but you have to be with people who understand you and are going the same direction, who are doing, you know. And I've used this when you and I have spoken publicly in groups, and spare me, I'm getting all wound up here because I just want to teach people, but I get all excited. But I've shared this when you and I have presented, that a Stanford study on women who had breast cancer put half of them in a support group and the other half not. And the ones who were in a support group lived 37 months longer than those who were not in the group. So that's over amazing. 3 years. If that does not show you that you need people. And like I mentioned already tonight, because I know there's people are going to think to type in, well, we don't have a support group. You can build one or two other moms, just build one, just find somebody.
Well, and obviously we have the virtual one that I do through Starlight. So that you just go to starlightmin.org. We are off for the summer. We're off for the summer. Unless you want to just lie to your friends and tell them that you're still in, which works too. But
you're right.
No, in general, those will start up again in September. So, you know, and the virtual support groups are amazing. It doesn't have to be in person. It really does not.
It does. And I never thought when I started my business, my business consultant asked me about virtual counseling. I said, I don't think that's going to be a big part of my job. I just don't see how that's going to go. It is a huge part of what I do. And I do a three-part checkpoint with people virtually, and the relationships. I have actually, in the last 2 months, been in the physical presence of someone that I've only met virtually, and it was like no different.
Yeah.
It didn't, feel like a stranger. It was like, oh, there's so-and-so. And it's like, wow, that's so weird.
I know.
Because we have never physically met.
I know. We just had a get-together too.
Yeah.
There's this wonderful woman from California. Hopefully she'll be listening sometime. I mean, I got to meet her for the first time. I had been communicating with her just virtually for all this time, and it just felt pretty normal.
Yeah. Absolutely. And I didn't think that you
wouldn't think that it would, but it really did.
No. And that's why if someone feels all alone, you can virtually connect with people. And, you know, I said to someone, you're wearing mascara, that was virtually, I could even see the mascara.
Yeah.
Right. She looked different. Yeah.
Okay. So we're sort of running out of time. Oh, did you have one more thing? You did.
No, a couple people talked about retreats too. And I know you've had some on your show. You have one coming up, I think.
That one's full. Did I tell you it filled up?
No.
The retreat. Yeah. We're very excited about it. So,
yeah.
Yeah. So what I wanted to do for a second here, I want to talk about two things. Mm-hmm. One, I reached out to Gwen. Was it last week when I reached out to you? Last week or maybe 10 days ago, I had no episodes recorded after this live stream. None. And I'm usually a month ahead at least. So I've usually got 4 to 6 recorded and at least 2 months worth planned out. And I had nothing. And I've never worried about it because I feel like it always just falls into place. Like God people just fall into place. They start writing in and they'll ask me and I'll put them on, but I never really have to go out and try to recruit people. And I did have a couple people that had sort of expressed some interest. So week 10 days ago, I reached out to a couple people that had said maybe they wanted to be on. I reached out to you, Gwen, and said, hey, do you know anybody? Because I don't know what I'm going to do. I reached out to Stephanie. She was going to email a few people. And literally less than 24 hours went by. I think like 18 hours went by after these emails went out. And I had 3 people, totally unrelated, unsolicited, write and ask to be on the podcast. But I just thought to myself, you know, just when I start to get like worried about it, I shouldn't have worried about it. Like I wasn't worried about it until I got to the point where I am releasing this one in 2 days. And then I have Gwen next week and then I've got nothing. So I was really panicky about it, but I don't need to panic. I don't know. But that being said, if you would like to share your story on the podcast, certainly reach out. And then maybe I won't get to that panic mode again. But because I'd love to share stories. Last thing that I wanted to talk about was the next one of these. So we talked a lot about songs and about music and how it can affect you, right? And so I wanted to share a story from yesterday. So yesterday I was, you know, singing in the worship band. And we had a song that we were singing called Forgiveness. And, oh, man, why can't I remember who sings that song? It's very common. It's a very popular Christian song. But it was on forgiveness. And there were only going to be 3 of us singing. And it was the song of the day. So she likes to kind of give solo verses to that. So our leader said, okay, Dan, you take the first verse. Marcy, you take the second verse. And I'll take the third verse. And the second verse was about, and it said, even when the jury and the judge tell you you have a right to hold a grudge, it's the whisper in your ear saying, let it be. And all I could think of was, you know, that I did that. I had to do that. That I was in a courtroom when everyone in the courtroom said I had every right to never forgive that woman who killed Andy. And yet that day I did anyway, and I let it go and I gave her a hug And after I gave her the hug, the judge got down off of the bench and gave me a hug. And I've since had someone email me that he had to go to court for something else and he was waiting. And there was some sort of traffic case, I think a distracted driver. I don't know what it was, but she told the story of Andy and the story of me forgiving the woman who killed him in her courtroom. So all I could think of yesterday as I was singing that, of course, was being in that courtroom. And I actually cried through the whole thing. So I'm like weeping as I'm singing. And one of the men came up to me afterwards, just a guy in the congregation. And he said, my daughter was killed too. That meant a lot to hear you sing that. So anyway, as I get done with that, I thought that's what I want our next episode to be on, is about forgiveness and blame. Because I think it's twofold. I think people blame others, and I think there's also a lot of people blaming themselves. And the importance of forgiving others, but also forgiving yourself too. Because parents end up feeling so much guilt, and we've done things on guilt before, and definitely, but I don't think we've done blame and forgiveness. And it just really hit me that that was the next thing that I wanted to do, was because, you know, even though everyone would have told me it would have been totally fine for me to just stay furious forever and hang on to that anger forever, I had to forgive her for me. And that's, you know what? And the third verse of that song, the third verse is that song, it says, the person that it really frees is you.
You.
Because that's what forgiveness does. It doesn't free the person you've forgiven. It frees you.
It's you.
So anyway, I'm going to have
to.
Go ahead. Sorry.
I told you that I spoke at church yesterday and gave the sermon. And I said it was, you know, kind of just relating what God had done about freedom. But it also, part of my message was, we're free to forgive.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
And it is a freedom. So we will take some of that, because it is.
I'm just going to announce it right now. So hopefully all of you will tune in and we'll have all these questions already, because Gwen always gives me all these questions. And so the date will be on Monday, July 22nd. Okay. Again, at 7:30 p.m. So Monday, July 22nd, 7:30 p.m. Eastern time. And you can all kind of tune in and we will talk about blame and forgiveness and kind of how to try to let go of that.
I'm already writing my questions down. They're just flowing.
Okay. Oh, they're flowing. Day.
Yep.
All right. Good. Anything else that you would like to share before we close here? Okay.
No.
Beautiful. Well, thank you so much.
Thank you. Take care.
Thanks for listening. If you found this helpful and would like to support the podcast, please leave a 5-star rating and comment. To help financially, you can type Andy's Mom, one word, to the number 53555. This provides a link to GiveButter, which allows donations through PayPal, Venmo, Apple Pay, or credit cards. GiveButter will provide a receipt of your tax-deductible donation. Or you can visit the donation page at andysmom.com/donate. Always Andy's Mom is a registered 501c3 and can receive donations through Thrivent Financial and Benevity. Marcy loves hearing from listeners. Please feel free to reach out to her via email at marcy@andysmom.com or on the Instagram or Facebook Always Andy's Mom accounts. Sign up for the email list to get weekly episode links as well as pictures of Marcy's guests and their children. Together, let's work to inspire hope one day at a time.